Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the wonderful Mr. Dress-Up.
Nice crowd you have here.
They're wonderful. You know, I've watched you like everybody. I've watched you for years. This is the first time we've met.
I believe it is. Isn't that strange? After seeing each other on TV for the last...
long time.
4 years for you, is it?
I've been here a while, yeah. But you're such a part of the Canadian fabric, and I guess it's hard for you to leave. There must be real mixed emotions.
Well, yeah, a lot of mixed emotions. I had to come to a decision about that. Once I decided, I had to go through with it. But now I'm thinking, should I have or not? I've got a couple more years in me. But actually, the show is going to be rerun for a long, long time.
Yeah, so generation after generation of kids can still get...
Right, so I'm still Mr. Dress-Up, whether I want to be or not.
How did it all start? There's a story about you and Fred Rogers.
Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers.
Right,
yes.
They both came here to Canada. And
I was living in Pittsburgh at the time, and I was unemployed, and I knew Fred from working together with him at WQED in Pittsburgh, which is a public television station.
Doing children's things back then?
I worked at the station doing a lot of different things because that's the only way they could pay me if I did all kinds of things.
Right.
So anyway, to make a very long story short, how short should I make it?
Short as you want, as long as you want.
Well, Fred asked me if I'd be interested in coming to CBC for 1 year to work on a program that he was trying out. This would be the first time he was seen on television. Prior to that, his show was, he was behind the scenes just doing puppets. And I'd made some of his puppets, so he asked me to come on as a puppeteer with him. So we came up here, and we did the show for a year, and then he went back to Pittsburgh and very nicely asked the people at CBC if they would be interested in using me on a new show that was called Butternut Square, which was going to replace that time slot. And they asked me, and of course I had no job, so I said, well, yes.
That always does it, doesn't it?
Yeah, oh yeah. And just through various things, we decided that I would do a character called Mr. Dress-Up, one of several characters on this show. So actually, I've been Mr. Dress-Up since 1964, but it wasn't until 1967 that it became called Mr. Dress-Up.
Rather phenomenal that the two of you would go off and have such extraordinary success in the same field.
Yeah, well, actually, Fred was a mentor to me. Working with him all that time, I absorbed an awful lot from the way he treated his audience, his concern for kids, because he's truly deeply committed to children's welfare. And on the other hand, I'm an actor who happened to get a good gig, but that was Fred's mission in life.
But then we see that the same thing followed for you. The actor with the good gig became involved in the children and the children's...
Yeah, the evolution
happened.
I think his attitude toward his audience rubbed off on me. And actually, you can't help but respect kids because they're such wonderful little beings.
It would be wonderful if everybody respected children. That's a key word, respect.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you finally decided that there are other things I want to do here. I've done this. Is that it?
I don't know what other things I want to do, but I was just approaching an age, and actually for the last 3 years, people have said, do you have any plans for retirement? And I think finally it got into me, and finally I said, do I have... Yeah, I guess I better retire. It looks like the thing to do. Because I've never had any goals in life. I never set my own goals. They always happen to me. So I think enough people suggested I retire. So I said, okay, if that's what you want, I'll retire.
But you know, I often say that to kids. It isn't important to know where you're going to be in 10 years. Because some people are lucky to know, I'm going to be a doctor, lawyer, or whatever.
I never knew.
No, but some people, we open this door, and that opens this door, and that's that opens fun. That door. And then all of a sudden, you have a career, and you're doing it, which is... Yeah.
Well, years ago, my father asked me, this is before I... was doing much of anything. I was knocking around from one theater, little theater, to another. And he said, Ernest, how can you stand not knowing now what you're going to be doing 6 weeks from now? And I said, gee, it's exciting, Dad. And he said, well, you know, if you would like, your mother and I can send you back to school and you can get a degree and then you can always teach. And I thought, I don't think I'd like to do that. I love being out of work now and then, not knowing where it's going to happen again. And my son's going through the same thing, and I can empathize with him. I never say, come on, Chris, when are you going to get real and get a real job? Because he knocked around, and
it's part of life.
He'll get the big break.
Yeah, it's part of life to knock around. If you don't knock around, you'll miss parts. So where are Casey and Finnegan?
Well, they've retired. They're in Hornby Island, British Columbia, which is a beautiful island, with Judith Lawrence, who is their creator.
And, so will you... This is so sad, isn't it?
They're there now.
Do you think... I mean, you talked about this. I mean, here's, you know, people kept saying the words, so you've decided, but I hear this little kind of almost doubt in your voice. Yeah, well, I mean, in 6 weeks you'd be going, okay, I'm sorry, I'm back. I think.
I can't do that. The mold is broken. No, but I'm sure you'd do the same thing if you decided, well, I want to retire, but there's a part of you that likes doing this.
Sure.
You like the...
you love it.
I don't get live applause on the show, but...
I don't
I just
often.
Get such a I just get such a kick of getting in the studio with all the people that helped to produce the show. The cameraman, they all kid me. We have a wonderful time. Everybody's like equal members of a family.
Yeah, it's fun.
And it's a real uplift. And I think that's the thing I'm going to miss the most.
Hmm.
So maybe once a week I'll just maybe come in and crash in here and other people's shows.
Anytime you want to crash this show, you just come on in. You must have some plans. What are you going to do with yourself? Do you golf? Are you going to write?
Yeah, I golf very
do
badly.
You?
Oh, terrible golf.
Gee, I'd come and beat you on the golf course anytime.
You probably could, but I love to do it. And I'm still going to be doing my touring show.
Oh, good.
And that takes
good.
Quite a lot of time. I'll still do personal appearances and telethons and, you know, that sort of thing. So, and I'll have to answer my mail because that'll keep coming in.
Oh, of course, because the show's still running.
It's still a rerun, but nobody knows it. So I'll be busy.
Do you own the show?
No, I don't. CBC
owns it. You
own
part of it?
No.
You get residuals?
Yep.
This is good. Who is this?
That is the Space Worm. And that was created by Denise Dickin, who is our wonderful costume creator. And it's part of a costume, a full costume. I'm the Space Worm.
Right.
Just like that. But then we have this that goes on my other arm, and that's my other Space Worm. So you get a very sort of a schizoid thing when if I'm playing the Space Worm, I'm the Space Worm.
And I'm the other Space Worm.
And they try to switch back and forth so they won't see my lips moving, except they never know what I'm going to say because I ad-lib a lot, so.
You sure do. Hi, Deanie, can I be on your show, too?
I'm just thrilled to have you on my show.
Isn't that a wonderful puppet?
Yeah, you know
so
who
talented.
I had on my show once who just was one of my great, great interviews and my great thrills was Kermit.
Oh,
because even though I knew it was a puppet, when he came up and talked to me, it wasn't a puppet, it was Kermit.
Exactly.
It was Kermit.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, the magic of our puppeteers are that they're all so good that you never think about there's a body down below making the puppet work.
This is our tickle trunk, the Deanie Petty tickle trunk.
Oh.
What have we got in here?
Oh, well, who knows? We never know what's in the tickle
we
trunk.
We never, I have no idea.
Oh, what a surprise. What happens if the lid drops?
I don't know. We'll get a new one.
The hinges will break. Okay, this is one of my favorite costumes here. This is the spider costume. This was created, I can't even remember the name of the fellow that did it.
Oh, it's beautiful. Do you have one for me, Mr. Dress-Up?
Well, let's see. You could call this a coat of arms.
Isn't that fabulous? That's great.
There's a headpiece that goes with it.
And this is Watermelon Man?
That's Tutti Frutti.
That's Tutti Frutti?
Seen only on our touring stage show.
Ah!
He's totally composed of, well, he's a fruitcake, I guess. But many are.
Oh, look at this.
Okay.
This is me, Mr. Dress-Up.
You can slip that on.
This is me.
You are now a penguin. Let's see you flap your wings.
Okay, wait a sec.
How are things down at the South Pole?
I learned this from Red Skelton. This is fabulous. Yeah. And this?
Well, that's one of the more quieter pieces of clothing that I wear.
May I?
Oh, sure.
Okay. I don't know. There could be a whole new career here. What do you think,
well,
Mr. Dress-Up?
You look so good that I'm sorry
Miss
that
Dress-Up.
I'm packing it all up. Oh, replacement.
A replacement.
A new
Ms.
Dress-Up. Ms. Dress-Up.
Well, I sure respect kids a lot.
Well, there you are. You
there
can
you
do
go.
It.
It's been such an honor to meet you after all these years.
And
I love
it.
Ladies and gentlemen, one of the great Canadians, Mr. Dress-Up.